bushwhacks were some of the worst days I've ever had in the mountains, or life, really.
And I tell people all the time, never underestimate the Catskill. You can't underestimate them.
Why the Catskills is such a great place for trout.
It was really the development of New York State. Catskills were responsible.
Now you're listening to Inside the Line, the Catskills.
All right, this thing looks like it's recording. I hope it is. We'll see later on if this is a failure. What's going on, everyone? Welcome to episode 63 of Inside the Line, the Catskills. I am here by myself tonight. I didn't have anything planned, but I didn't want to leave you guys hanging, so I decided to make up a episode of me just telling the stories of my hiking. I know when a lot of people hike together, they both go back and forth with stories of hiking. So if you guys are out in the trail, you're driving in a car, you can hear some of the stories I've had hiking either solo or with other people. It's usually just solo. So yeah, welcome to this episode. Yeah, it's a little weird being by myself. I gotta admit, once again, it's very weird being by myself. My phone just went off. Of course, gotta shut that off because a lot of stuff has been happening. I have a webinar that was Thursday. I have an article that I gotta write I don't even know what it's for. About plane crashes in the Catskills, and they keep telling me to update it like 500 times. It's getting really annoying. So now I got to send pictures of them. It's getting out of control. And, you know, work, two jobs, wanted to hike here and there, stuff like that. Time is very, very short. But I'm here. First, we're going to talk about some other places of hiking interest. I recently saw this on good old Facebook about Glacier National Park. In the previous years, there has been some vehicle restrictions located on the Going the Sun Road, a beautiful road that leads up to a high pass of some of the peaks in Glacier National Park. If you haven't heard of Glacier National Park, check it out. Very beautiful, stunning place. Now they are having road requirements for four different area and its vehicle registrations. The Going to the Sun Road, the North Fork, Two Medicine Area, and the Many Glacier Area. All these are popular, beautiful areas that were once accessible easily by a lot of people. You know, very easy to get to, very easy to hike, very easy to check out different places, very beautiful views. But now they are restricting access going by reservations. So let's see, 100 available portion of the reservations will be available approximately 120 days in advance using a block release system. I don't know what that is. I'm guessing that releases every certain hour, a certain amount and stuff like that. It's pretty crazy. What else? Release dates will be February 1st, March 1st, July 1st through the 31st. Just really crazy stuff. As you can see how big and popular hiking is getting, not just around this upstate New York and the Northeast, but around the world, actually. I was planning on going to Glacier National Park sometime in the future, and I still will probably go, but looks like I'm going to have to do some extra planning or go outside of this. And judging by the map that I see, a lot of the places that are being used for this reservation for the vehicles is every place that's like accessible to the best spots. But there are many spots that you can go that aren't the easiest, quickest, fastest ways up. So we will see about that. Wanted to share that information with you guys. Really crazy stuff. I once went up to, like I said, a couple episodes back, I went up to Canadian Rockies, and I was up there with my wife, and we went around place to place without any, you know, vehicle restrictions or shuttle buses or stuff like that. So it was a good time where we got to see everything we wanted to see. Parking lots were not limited. It was a fantastic time that we got to go up to the Canadian Rockies and see everything before the huge outbreak in hiking and, you know, national parks happened. Very, very crazy times that we are living in. Hopefully everybody can get this under control. All the parks places can get it under control. So not too much damage is done. And we go into the backcountry and it basically looks like a wide path that you can walk on in your town or city or something like that. So crazy, crazy stuff. So thank you to the monthly supporters, Darren White, Vicky Ferreira, John Comiskey, Jim C., who I saw earlier this week. Good to see you, Jim. Michael Bogner, David Mead, Matt Smith, and Sharon Klein. Thank you guys so much for being the monthly supporters of the show. Also, thank you to Outdoor Chronicles Photography for being the sponsor of the show. Molly from Outdoor Chronicles Photography specializes in adventure elopement and eventual coupled photography in the Catskills, Adirondacks, and the White Mountains. Don't forget your pets, though. They are just as important. She is also an officiant for getting married and a licensed guide, so don't hesitate to get a hold of Molly on all platforms. Thank you very much, Outdoor Chronicles Photography. So coffees, holy crap. You probably hear my dog barking. Sorry about that. Coffees, guys, thank you very much. I haven't been up to date on this, so I'm going to name everybody from the past couple weeks. Brenda Robbie, thank you for 5 coffees. She said that the sticker is awesome. Thank you. I really enjoyed getting that sticker out. And everybody, if you need a sticker, let me know. Send me a private message on Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter as well. Ryan Dangler, thank you very much for 3 coffees. He said, thanks for keeping me informed and entertained. I'm here for that. Jen T, thank you for 3 coffees. Love listening to your podcast on my long drive to hike in the Cats. Great info and conversations. Hopefully I can keep that up. So thank you very much, Jen T. And Rob Ward for 3 coffees. He said, listen to your podcast this AM and loved it. Thank you very much, Rob, Jen T, Ryan, and Brenda for the coffees. Appreciate it. So I'm not having anything to drink tonight. I just got on and I didn't mix me anything to drink, but cheers to everyone. I haven't been on any previous hikes either. It's been, once again, a long, busy month of work, basically, and trying to catch up with everything. The webinar, the plane crashes. It's just been out of control. Catskill News, definitely volunteering. Planning is starting to pick up some pace. So check out some volunteer opportunities anywhere in the Catskills. Let me know if you need help getting a hold of those organizations or such, and I can definitely get a hold of them for you. I can do what I can. I can point you in the right direction as well. So please let me know if you guys want to volunteer. A lot of cool winter festivals are going on. I remember one that was just happening in Stanford. Very neat stuff. Yeah, so volunteer. Go to your local places to pick up some gear or stuff like that. You know, at this time of year right now, we are actually going to be hitting a massive cold front. Really massive. Projected temperatures are going to be in the negatives, and then the wind chills are going to be some places negative 40. At my place in Oneonta, it's supposed to be a projected wind chill of negative 41. So crazy, crazy stuff. So be prepared. Bundle up. Spike it up. Snowshoes, bring everything because it is going to be cold, number one, and you're going to need your traction till April. Yes. Also, if you guys want to be pointed in the right direction of some gear, let me know. I have mine all written down. I will let you know what I use. Anything else you need, let me know. So how about we break it into some Catskill Mountain history? So I found this article online from a friend of mine. It was written by Ken Osborne. It's called A Brief History of the Valley of the Beaverkill. Beaverkill Valley is a very cool place. I had a discussion in episode 54 with my friend Will, who talked about the Beaverkill Valley located in the western part of the Catskills. It's a very secluded area, very remote lands, which is a valley filled with trout fishing and other recreational stuff. It's very beautiful. Check out episode 54. It's pretty sweet. So yeah, this came from, once again, Ken Osborne, and it's about the Beaverkill Valley. The white man who gets credit for making their first trip through the Beaverkill Valley is Jehethel Stewart. Accompanied by his family and brother Luther, he made the trip from Warsing. The brothers cut their way with the axes, and the family and household goods drawn on an old ox sled followed. The journey, about 25 miles down the river, took 2 weeks before reaching his destination on the flats of Rockland. Stuart was forced to cross and recross the Beaverkill River 25 times. Stuart had approached the valley from Lackawack, fording the Neversink. He avoided the old trail of the Indians, known then as the Sun Trail and later to the white man as Hunter Road. In the old days, the Sun Trail was beset with danger. This footpath over which the savages traveled connected the Esopus tribe with their larger reserve store of maize and beans at the Wawasing and the Hudson and Delaware River Valley. Further up the Beaverkill, a trail near Turnwood, known as Cross Mountain Trail, branched to the north. To the west was the Mary Smith Trail, and the further west, the Berry Brook Trail, running north to the Papacton. In the beginning, the Beaverkill Valley had only a few ways leading to it, and once in, and only a few footpaths out. Along the Drybrook and Millbrook, the river rises in a pocket guarded by three high mountains, each over 3,300 feet above tidewater area. Waters to the east are sent down into the Hudson. On the west, Graham, Balsam, and Eagle Mountains form the Great Divide. The Delaware is their destination. The course through which the river raced from the south to the north and then turning from east to west at Turnwood was a natural barrier. To the warring tribes of the great nations of the Algonquin and Iroquois, it was one and at the same time borderland and happy hunting ground. Possession of the almost impenetrable mountains for the trees was highly prized. It was a matter of wonderment how an area of such as the Beaverkill Valley could be successively first an Indian fortress, then a source of endless supply of soft wood to the sawmills along the river, still later provide untold tons of hemlock bark for the extraction of acid to tan raw hides at the river tanneries, and today offer the city of New York more than enough sand and gravel to the line of the many miles of tunnel of 16-foot concrete aqueduct in the city's water system. Nor can fly fishermen who wade the white waters of the Beaverkill cease to wonder how it came about every foot of the river is bedded with great depths of rocks of all sizes, colors, and shapes. Modern geological studies, popularized in current publications, go back a long ways, back to the earliest beginnings, in fact, to account for the area containing Beaverkill Valley's fantastic terrain and that of the surrounding Catskills. Hope you enjoyed that little snippet of Catskill Mountain history. By the way, that was written in 1950, so some of the stuff I might have said sounded a little odd, kind of like the sandstone and quarry stuff that was an endless supply to the New York City was not really at this time. So, done in 1950, that was by Ken Osborne. I will post the link in the show notes. So, let's get on to the guests of the night.
Me!
Let's go!
Yeah, me. So, once again, I didn't really have anything planned, so I decided to do a little snippet on some of my tales and trails and the hikes in the Catskills. So, yeah, basically, I always think of when we're out on the trail, when people are talking, we always talk about our experiences with the Catskills, experiences in other places as well. So I was just like, might as well do one of mine to fill in the void of this episode. So, yeah. So one day I decided to go up Sherrill Mountain, do a little bushwhacking, to have fun. It was a beautiful day. It was probably a spring day. It was probably around maybe like 50 to 60 degrees. Beautiful, beautiful day. I get all my stuff ready. I hammer in my points on my GPS and I also hammer in my degrees my compass, because I wanted to check out my compass skills to see if I can get to the top by just using a compass once again. I'm very confident in my compass skills. So I just wanted to knack back into it and see if I could do it really good. So get out of the car. I hop over the creek, start hitting that ridge going up to Sherrill, pounding away, pushing up the mountain. Everything's going good. I hit a little flat spot. I take a breather, then I start chugging up again, and then there's this area where these rocks are all over the place, and I stepped on the rock wrong, and I slid a little bit, and then my foot went into a hole of leaves. I then like couldn't catch myself because my poles were weird, and I fall down face forward, and I hit my head on a rock. I don't know if I was knocked out for a couple seconds or not, but I got up and I was just like a little woozy, and all of a sudden, you know, I felt my head and I felt a little bit of dampness. So I immediately went into sorrow mode, dumped everything out of my pack, see what I had. I had a bunch of gauze pads, so I put them on there, but it wasn't bleeding too bad. I didn't have any tape, so what I had to do was put the gauze pads over the wound and then put my hat on really low. I looked like basically back when I was a 90s kid. It was actually really funny. And I sat there. I had something to eat. I was checking it every, like, you know, 30 seconds, make sure I was all good. Sat there, took a breather, be like, should I quit right now? Should I summit? Should I not summit? You know, should I just turn around? I decided I wanted to go summit. So that's what I did. Actually, I went to the viewpoint first, which is one of the best viewpoints in the Catskills. If you haven't been there, definitely go there. But I went over to the viewpoint. I followed the side of the mountain, went down to the viewpoint, beautiful spot, went back up, summited, went back down, took it extra slow, extra slow, so I didn't have any bad falls or stuff like that just happened previously before. And on the way down, I was just like thinking, you know, I got a little tiny bit of a headache. I'm surprised I didn't have a really big headache, but I'm just like, man, I've had this happen to me before, and it was playing ice hockey, and I tripped over like a little crevice in the ice, and I fell face first right on the ice without my helmet. So I was just like, oh man, this is going to suck, because it's going to be a huge, like, gouge on my head. It's going to look like I have like a stinking orange in there. And I was just like, man, this is going to be fun. So 2 days later, I get a massive swelled up black eye, and I had a little goose egg there, and it was just, it was crappy. And it wasn't that fun, but it's a really funny story to tell. But, you know, I was completely ready if something did happen. It was a beautiful day, so I was fortunate about that. If it wasn't a beautiful day, I probably wouldn't have hiked. But that one story of just slamming my head into the ground and just being like, oh God, and instantly getting up and being like, let's do this, you know, like fight or flight. We got to get this thing sealed up. At least I summited. That's what I said. It was summit fever, even though I didn't need it for anything. To be honest, I really didn't need the peak for anything. I just wanted to get out and hike and bushwhack. So that was definitely an awesome story. Another story I had is when I went hiking with my friend John. We went up Plateau Mountain in the wintertime, and this was his first time he's ever gotten to use snowshoes. And, you know, of course, it's a little bit awkward at first, and right after he put them on, he started to move. He's like, wow, these things are amazing. This and that, you know, I can do anything in this. We do not summit the mountain because I realize a little bit, he doesn't have really good crampons on the bottom of it. So going up Plateau, we went from the east side. So a little bit steeper from Mink Hollow, a little bit steeper, a little bit crazier than the other side. But well, I knew he couldn't summit just because he didn't have the full on crampons on the bottom, and that section can get very icy and very difficult and very steep. You definitely need crampons or some form of hardcore traction to get up through there. So we go back down, we butt slide down. It was fun. Lots of snow. A week later, I go back and the weather has changed pretty dramatically. It melted a lot. And I go up the same exact path. This time I wanted to summit because I needed it for a winter peak, I think. I don't know. Maybe. And all of a sudden, I start going up off on the Devil's Path. I start taking a ride up the Devil's Path, and it starts getting icier and icier and icier. All-out waterfall, basically. A frozen waterfall from the bottom of the col all the way to the top. On my way up, I have my Hill Sounds, my micro spikes, and I'm just like, all right, this is going to be challenging on the way down. And luckily, I brought my full-on crampons with me. My crampons were there with me, my full-on 10-point crampons. And I was on the way up towards the top, and I'm just like, this is, you know, I start thinking, I'm like, this is going to be crazy. I'm going to have to put my full-on crampons down. I get to the top, I summit. I don't even want to go to the viewpoint. So it was I knew it was going to be a little bit crappy at the viewpoint, so I didn't want to take the chance. But I was just like, I just want to get down this mountain. I took a selfie at the top, and you can definitely see in my face the how scared I was, how terrified I was to go down this side of the mountain with these crampons on. And this isn't the first time I've worn full-on crampons. First time in the Catskills I've worn crampons. But I once did some glacier hiking in the Canadian Rockies, and I used them there, and it was pretty cool. But, you know, this was my first time in the Catskills using full-on crampons and also coming down a steep pitch of the mountain, steep part of the mountain, using the crampons. So it was a little new to me. So I was terrified. I was also solo. You know, I hike solo mostly all the time because Tuesdays is my only day to hike. And sometimes my buddy John doesn't want to do crap with me. So, yeah. So put the crampons on. I start going down on the flat trail from the summit, and we start descending and ascending. It gets a little bit steeper. And next thing you know, I'm coming down, like stomping into the ground, into the ice, just making sure I got some traction. And it is terrifying. I took a video of it, and it was just absolutely terrifying. I never, don't know if I would ever do that again. Maybe I would. But with another person or two or three people, really, because it was just very terrifying how thick the ice was, how much you realize the distance is between the trees that you have to navigate. So if you were to slip on this area of Plateau Mountain, you would be falling 20 feet to the next tree, and then you'd have to catch it. That's a long time to be sliding down some steep ice. You'll gain a lot of speed, so it'll hurt. So I was extremely terrified, and I barely took out my phone for parts of it. I took my phone out to video record and take a picture of the flatter parts, where seriously, it looked like a massive iced over waterfall. And once again, first time I've used full-on crampons in the Catskills, the only time I used full-on crampons in the Catskills, and it was definitely terrifying, and I gotta admit, I shouldn't have gone solo, but you know what, I did. I learned a lot that day. I learned one thing to do is not to wear a little bit baggier pants when you're wearing full-on crampons, because the lag that it gives you, you'll catch it onto your crampon, and it'll slice your right through your pants, or you'll catch on to it and then you'll fall, and then you're, I wouldn't say dead, but you're probably close to getting very seriously injured. So very good learning time, very crazy day that I probably don't want to do it again, but who knows. We always say that. We always say we're never going to do that again, but you know, we always do. Like I always freaking bushwhack, and I always say never going to do that again. But I do it again. Why is that? Big question. Good question. Another crazy time on the trail is when I was after we had a massive snowstorm up in Oneonta, at least, and it dumped 3 feet of snow. So I was just like, oh, the next day it's going to be a beautiful bluebird day, fresh snow in the Catskills. It's going to be a stunning time. Let me go and maybe break some trail. And I was like, maybe I should go to Camel's Hump. I was like, maybe I should do Thomas Cole and Camel's Hump. Cross them off the list. Yeah, definitely. Stupid idea. Get there. At least I had to shovel my that side part. I had to dig out this little spot of with a snow shovel on the side of Barnum Road, where you have that little park right by the sign. Because you couldn't park in the snowplow turnaround. Didn't want to do that. Didn't want to be that kind of guy. So did that. Started breaking trail. It wasn't too bad in the beginning because it was at a lower elevation, but it was still pretty tough. Signing at the register, you know, that little nice 1 mile in flat walk, beautiful snowshoe stuff, fluffy stuff like that. I started gaining an elevation, and the further I went up, the deeper it got, the tougher it got. And of course, I was once again solo. I really don't recommend doing snowshoeing, breaking trail in that craziness of depth of snow. It must have been 3 to 4 feet of snow up there, especially at the higher elevations when I got to Camel's Hump. But on the way up, I was trudging and I was dying, sweating like crazy, and just thinking like, man, this is horrible. I should have either taken an easier route or I should have just stayed on the lower peaks and just done some easy classic snowshoeing on the lower slopes. So once I got up to the top of Claudel's Hill, I think that's what they call it. I hope I'm saying it right. I started going over to Camel's Hump and I was like, all right, this is going to be nice. It's nice, you know, to that smooth transition from Claudel's Hill to Camel's Hump. And all of a sudden, you know, you start gaining right before you get to Camel's Hump and the snow got super thick. I'm like I'm seriously, I forgot what the name of the storm was, but it was a big, significant storm and it was a lot of goddamn snow. So I'm breaking trail up through there and, you know, I'm stopping every 10 feet because I'm dead. I'm seriously dead. Get to the top of Camel's Hump and I'm like, screw this. I'm not going over to Thomas Cole. I'm on my way back down. I'm dead. I think it took me 2.5 hours to get to Camel's Hump. Now, usually it takes me like 1 hour and 15 minutes to get up there. It's like 2.3 miles. So not even a mile per hour. I'm surprised that it took me even that short of a time because it probably should have taken 4 hours. Two people, that would have been fine. Maybe three people, that would have been fantastic. But on my way back down, you know, I'm still kind of breaking trail because I had to trudge through that whole time of, or that whole feet of snow and death. I come to the top of Claudel's Hill and I come down and all of a sudden I see some more people coming. I'm like, oh, cool. I mean, good for them. They're ripping it up. It was about 5 or 6 people. And all of a sudden I notice that they don't have snowshoes on. And I'm like, are you freaking kidding me? So I stop with them and I chat with them. They spoke very little English and they were looking to get to Thomas Cole. And I'm just like, you guys are going to have a horrible day if you continue going without snowshoes. I'm like, you've already gotten this far. You might as well just call it quits because it's just going to get worse with the depth of snow. They didn't really, I don't know if they understood me or just didn't care, but there was 6 of them, I remember, at the top of this part, making up the steep section right up before Claudel's Hill, right before that little viewpoint that you get from Barnum Road when you get from there. But they didn't care. They kept going on. So I come down that little part, and then I look over to my right, and there is a bunch more people over there. There is like probably 10 to 15 people over there off of my snowshoe tracks, creating their own trail. And I'm like looking like, what the hell are you guys doing? So I was just like, I was looking over and I'm like, are you guys okay? And they just waved at me. I don't think they understood what I said, but I was just like, wow, this is pretty crazy. And they're breaking trail with no snowshoes, nothing whatsoever. And I'm in my mind, I'm like, wow, they are going to hate today. And they're probably never going to go hiking again, but who knows. But I'm flying down the trail because once there's snow, flying down the trail and a good depth, like a good snow depth, you can just like huff and just jump and run. It's really actually fantastic. It's a good time. But other than that, I was just thinking, I was like, what are these people doing here? Like they have no snowshoes, number one, which is like a general rule, up in the Adirondacks, I think it's, I don't know if it's a law or not, but they, up in the Adirondacks, they fine you if you don't have snowshoes, when there's 8+ inches, I believe. So, I mean, once they started probably hiking, they probably regretted doing that, but hey, never know. Maybe they liked it. Maybe not. I know I didn't, but so if anybody wants to break trail, I would gladly go with you because I don't want to do it again solo because it's a pain in the ass. But yeah, that was a fun experience going up there breaking trail for Camel's Hump. And then, you know, I think a year or two later, we have a massive snowstorm and I decide that I'm like, let me rephrase that. It wasn't massive. I think Oneonta got 10 inches. So I'm just like, okay, so the Catskills probably got anywhere between like, you know, a foot and a half. Cool. I'll go up and I'll, you know, summit Windham High Peak. Peck Road's a pretty good, easy accessible place. Why not? So I go up and once again, I had to dig myself, my own parking spot because I didn't want to, you know, park in a spot where they would turn around. So I went over the far corner where they could easily turn around and I dug myself my own parking spot. I look over and they plowed up to the sides and I couldn't even see the trail register or the kiosk. I was like, oh man, this is pretty hardcore. So I get in there, I sign in, and basically when I'm signing in, you know, you got the register basically chest height. Well, I'm looking down and I had to bend down a little bit to sign into the register. That's how much snow there was. I definitely underestimated. It wasn't a foot, wasn't a foot and a half. It was over 2 feet, maybe 3 feet of snow that I underestimated. And I was just like, oh man, this is going to be pretty cool. So, you know, when you start from Peck Road, the elevation gain isn't that bad, but it's pretty steady and it's very nice. It's very gradual. So I started up from there and I crossed a bunch of snow bridges, which was pretty fun. And then, once you start getting to that little steady incline, I was huffing and puffing. I was like, holy crap. I think I shared pictures before. So if you ever go back and look on my Instagram page or something like that, my Instagram or Facebook page, I have some of those pictures and you could see how deep the snow was. And I was just trudging, but it was beautiful, beautiful. Once again, bluebird day. It must have been really cold, but I was stripped down to my long sleeve t-shirt. So I was huffing and puffing. All of a sudden, I come about 3/4 of the way up. I come across some tracks. I'm like, oh, I'm like, somebody bushwhacked up the side of the mountain and then got on the trail. I get closer and closer and I notice that they're not snowshoes. I was like, interesting. So I look and I get closer and they're bear tracks. And you could see the way the bear like wobbled up, tried to pick up his legs, but you know, it was too big and it couldn't. And it was just kind of like floating through the snow. And I was just like, oh, a bear broke trail for me now. I'm like, this is going to be interesting. And they looked fresh in the morning. Like maybe it might have done it last night when the snow stopped, but it was fairly, fairly fresh. And it was just really crazy. So all the way I went probably like almost up to the trail junction of the escarpment trail and such, Route 23. And just before that, the bear decided to go back downhill and he did kind of like a circle loop and came back down. It was pretty cool. Once I got up to the trail junction, I went over to the lean-to and I decided to call it quits. I was like, I can't make it up Windham High Peak by myself, breaking trail. Once again, stupid decision by me, but I decided to call it quits. And at that time, it started getting a little bit windier and getting a little bit colder. So I was just like, all right, this is a good time, and flew back down the mountain. It was beautiful. Once again, bluebird day, one of those days you cannot forget. And the bear breaking trail was just absolutely cool as heck. Sorry, the wife gave me a call there. But yeah, the bear breaking trail up to that one part and then took a little side turn was pretty cool. And then I went up to the lean-to and decided to call it quits from there because it was just, I was exhausted. I didn't think there would be that much snow. I didn't think it would be that difficult, even though this wasn't my first time breaking trail, but it was just a pain to get up that far, even though it's only like 1.2 miles in. I was dead and I knew I had another 2 miles to go with going up to Windham High Peak. So it was definitely one of those times of when I'm just like, I'm done. I've had fun. Once again, there's somebody sending me a message. Oh, it's Air Doctor. Look at that. But yeah, I was done. I was just like, all right, I'm exhausted. So I go back down and beautiful hop and a skip and a jump down, which was, you know, fun and all. And, you know, the massive amount of snow on the trees, the massive amount of trees hanging down, just brushing on you was absolutely phenomenal. So it was one of those awesome times. What are some other ones? So some like other ones, you know, I've met random people on the trail. I met my friend Mark on the trail when we did Twin Mountain. My wife and I did Twin Mountain. That was really cool. We sat up there, we talked, we exchanged numbers, and I told him I do a podcast about the Catskills, and he was very, very excited, and he checked it out. He liked it, and then we've hiked several times since then. It was really cool, and I met, you know, a bunch of other people on the trails, like Ralph Rindeck. If you don't know who Ralph Rindeck, he is a master of the Catskills. They call him the Man of the Moon Hall, but he's a cool dude. trying to think of other ones that were notable. So another one is me, my friend James, who was previously on the show, and his friend Sean decided to bushwhack up Cornell from the Moonhaw. Now, the ridge going up there looks a little intimidating, but not too bad. And we hadn't planned on going full summit. We just wanted to do kind of like a wraparound of Wittenberg and look for possible views. But we decided to go straight up that ridge and go straight up to the summit. It was pretty crazy. Yeah. Very, very crazy, because once we got up to a certain part, it started having like massive ledges after ledges. I'm guessing there was probably 6-7 pitches going up to the top of Cornell Mountain. And what a rush, but what crazy part that was. It was just, it was beautiful, fun bushwhacking and good times with James and Sean. And like I said, once you get up, we got up to those certain parts. We had to decide, you know, like, are we going to keep going? Yeah, sure. Let's keep going. So we kept going. We just decided to every part, we're just like, okay, where do we got to go? We got to move around here. We might have to go up here, but then, you know, we might get caught. Really good times. Beautiful views on the way up. It was a beautiful day. I remember that was one of my last climbs before I had my back problems. I've had sciatica stuff, you know, bulging disc, and it was one of my last climbs, and it was a fantastic climb. Summited Cornell, went down over to the dink and descended down through the dink, and that was a nice fun falling day, because you know, this was during the fall, and when the leaves are off of the trees, they make potholes everywhere, and it was just a big mess. But it was very fun. One of the most memorable hikes I had, especially with Jim. Jim's always a great time to go with. If you ever get a chance to go out with James Hobson to hike, do it, because it is absolutely phenomenal time. I mean, it's only 38 minutes, but I feel like 38 minutes talking by myself is good enough. So I'm going to let you guys go. Sorry about the lack of episodes. It's been very busy for me and getting a hold of people to maybe do something. But, you know, I'm glad I took some time off. And, time off. It wasn't really time off, because I was doing like 7,000 other things. But definitely, I hope you guys are still enjoying the show. I got a bunch of interesting interviews coming on. I can't wait. Hopefully, if this doesn't get out, it should get out Monday, hopefully. Thank you for listening to the show, and sorry that you had to listen to this crapshoot of an episode today. So, enjoy. Have a good night.
Hey guys, I just want to thank you for listening to the show. If you enjoyed the show, subscribe and throw down a smooth review on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or any podcast platform that you use. You can also check daily updates of the podcast, hikes, hiking memes, and local news on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and the official website of the show. Remember this, you just keep on living, man. L-I-V-I-N.